anybody. My main motive behind this presentation is to introduce what are the sustainable development goals which is introduced in 2050 by United Nations Development Goal. And they have set some targets to achieve these 17 goals they have set to achieve. So we are particularly talking about the production of the indigenous knowledge in reducing poverty and sustainability, sustainable cities and communities, and also the life on land. They have set some subset also to achieve, how to achieve the goals. So I just have to mention here that how our own actions are actually matter to achieve this concept of sustainability. So this concept, like this is the, I'm actually concentrating on the presentation prepared by Samuel Meyer. He delivered a talk on planetary health and what is like how our actions are affecting our own health and well-being. So on a Christmas evening, 1968, Bill Anders took a photograph of Earth rising above the sun, making the iconic images of the environmental movement and the first Earth Day in 1970. So this picture is not only mentioning that, like, it is not only depicting the iconic images of the environmental day, but it also reveals the fact that we are entering a geological epoch, that is an Anthropocene. That is, humanity had become the dominant force changing our planet's biophysical conditions. So what is actually the through this graph, all the use of water and transportation, fertilizer, paper production, plastic production, all of this use are increasing like in an alarming rate, and also correspondingly this terrestrial biosphere, that is loss of our biosphere is getting lost, and like fisheries also like the production is so increasing, like the use of fisheries also increasing, carbon dioxide the emission is increasing, and there is ocean acidification, and there is also tropic forest loss. All these are also correspondingly increasing by the use of all the resources. So actually the data reveals that we use about 40% of ice-free desert, free terrestrial surface for pastures and cropland, and we also use about half of our planet's accessible water largely to irrigate our crops, and we also exploit 90% of global fisheries at or beyond the maximum sustainable limit. So what is happening is that, like, for this, what we are doing is that we have cut down 7 to 11 million kilometers square of the world's forest, and more than 60% of our rivers. So the quality of air, water and land is diminishing in many parts of the world because of increasing global pollution. Diminishing in many parts of the world because of increasing global pollution, reducing population size of mammals, fishes, birds, reptiles and amphibians by half in the past 45 years. But after this also, like, we are achieving some kind of human development growth rate, that is, there is steady improvement in most of the measures of human health, life expectancy is increasing. That is, 47 years in 1950, 55 to 69 years in 2005, then worldwide mortality in children younger than 5 years has increased from 240 deaths per 1,000 live births in 1950, 55 to 59 deaths per 1,000 live births in 2005-10. So that is actually a positive. This is a positive trend is showing, but the actual fact is that what is happening is that, like, we, for this to achieve this human development, we have been mortgaging the health of future generation to realize economic and development gains in the present. So this the planetary health concept introduced from this study that like these changes in the condition of our lives ultimately affect every dimension of our health and well-being, including nutritional outcomes, infectious disease, non-communicable disease, displacement and conflict, and mental health outcomes. So how I'm just giving a brief idea about how the nutrition are how this affects our health and well-being. That is staple food. These staple food are crops are growing in the open field condition. That is, it is growing in the the field which has lot of carbon dioxide emissions. Concentrations are there. So like in this crops, there will be low amounts of iron, zinc and protein. Then, if it consumes more carbon dioxide, there will be lower amounts of iron, zinc and protein. So the impact of this nutrition impoverishment of human health are likely to be large. About 150 to 200 million people are likely to experience new onset of zinc deficiency, and a similar number will be pushed into protein deficiency as a result of anthropogenic carbon dioxide emissions. And if there is infectious disease, that is a fertilizer use, the study finds that the place called bellies, that the upper land of the this bellies, the farmer use the fertilizer actually came across the rainwater, and that caused for some kind of growth of the mosquito that actually spread the malaria. And the displacement and conflict is also happening. The role of accelerating environmental change in driving displacement of conflict is uncertain. And the total numbers of poor people being forced to move because of the rising sea levels, failing crops, resource scarcity, extreme weather events, or the civil conflicts that can be generated by all of these events remain unknown. And there is non-communicable disease. According to this study on pollution and health, estimated 9 million excess deaths resulted from global pollution of air, water and land in 2015. 71% of these deaths were caused by non-communicable diseases. According to the Commission's report, pollution caused 21% of deaths from cardiac disease, 23% of deaths from stroke, 8% death from chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and 25% death from lung cancer. And also, it is affecting the mental health is that there is direct effect of natural disasters associated with changing environmental condition, that is, as example, sea level rise and more extreme storms, fires, floods, heat waves, and droughts are known to include stress, anxiety, depression, and post-traumatic stress disorder. Displacement comes with large mental health burdens as well. In a study of recently refugee children and adolescents, the prevalence of PTSD was 30 to 75%. So we can reduce the vulnerability, that is through they suggested that through good governance, wealth, robust technology and infrastructure, access to philanthropy and aspects of culture and behavior can protect population from the worst effects of disrupted natural systems. So I just have to introduce here that my work I have done for my PhD is actually the first slide I have shown that in the sustainability development goals, they are giving importance for the protection of the indigenous knowledge. But what is actually happening is that from the field survey I have done for my PhD in Wayanad District of Kerala, it is all over the India what is happening that after the introduction of the various forest policies in India, from post-colonial to pre-colonial and also recent forest policies, they actually deny the access of the forest coming to the forest. So after the introduction of 2006, actually the 2006 Forest Act had introduced for the to restore the rights of the forest community on their own land, but it was actually the data shows that in some part of India, that is one of the district in Kerala and some part of Tripura, some part of Maharashtra, they actually in these places there are some successful cases. Otherwise, they don't get any kind of forest land, or they own, still they are they do not have the access to the forest resources. So, like the study which I am focused for the for my PhD is that how these forests, the design of the forest policies are affecting the traditional medicine and knowledge of the various tribal communities in Payyanur district. So, like the Payyanur community, what they actually do is that like they collect the forest resources. They go for the treatment. While coming back, they collect the forest medicinal plants. So like nowadays, this what is happening that overuse of fertilizer or the depletion of the resources. They can collect the these kind of forest resources. And also, multi-kurma tribal communities, there is indirect effect that their families getting like nuclear family, and they are actually open to the there are inter-tribal marriages. That is. So like the knowledge is also getting exchanged with the other community. So like that is also kind of threat to the knowledge that is getting misappropriation. So the Kathmandu communities, it is concerned that is they are the they have been the communities that they were living inside the forest, near part of the forest, and they have vast medicinal knowledge. And these communities, they adopted a system that like because of this denial of the to the forest to the forest resources, they actually collect the forest medicinal plants and they make a wall and dig it into the this on the land. But again, what is happening that it is affecting the quality of the medicine, that like all of this use of this pesticides that is actually affecting the medicinal practices. And also the rural kurmas, because of the policies of wildlife protection and the government policies to promote alternative energy, they actually cannot cultivate medicinal plants, or like they can't use that they can use the medicinal plants like as they want. So from the data collected 10-year data collected from the scheduled type surveys cooperative society, actually what is happening that Ayurveda pharmaceuticals, they come and collect the medicinal plants in a large scale. And also like that time, what is happening is that they don't actually look at what is the season to collect, or how to collect it scientifically. But the medicinal these healers, they know that like what season which plant can be collected and how to regenerate. Also, this collection of this huge scale of Ayurvedic medicine plants also affecting. This is also a possible depletion of the medicinal plants. So, I just have to introduce some kind of the traditional way of protecting the natural resources. That it is. I do not see that, but I heard about that. Like, this is a traditional way of protecting water. Actually, they use some kind of toady cup, this thing, outer layer, and protect this water. This actually this contains water all of the year, and they use it. And also, like this is the some kind of culture they are practicing. The time called Tulavathu. This kind of culture practices I am going to study only, the what is the relevance and how it is affecting the life and other living conditions. And this is actually the I've taken photo at the time of my fieldwork. This is still they are using the traditional way of making medicines. That is the traditional furnace they are using to make the medicines. This is by Gurucha communities. And also, they are storing these medicinal plants. Also, they are using very traditional method of to store the medicinal plants. And they have vast variety of rice variety, and some tribal communities are there keeping some kind of more than 50 kind of rice varieties which have medicinal values. But again, because of some kind of this land issue, they cannot cultivate it properly these days. And it is also a threat that they are trying to protect it, but like, it is also a threat. That is what, like, and this is. Because they did not implement the forest right and properly, so they are saying that like they are like not eligible for the land. But it is the fact that like they did not implement the forest policy, so they don't have the forest land. So the people who do not have the forest land, Supreme Court asked them to go out of the forest.
Okay, so if the 2005 forest right
act. This is after the implementation of 2006, the recent act, but it did not get implemented. So, like the some kind of issues are going on, the case is going on.
If it is implemented, then do these people would actually get the land?
They should get it, but then that is again the question that will get implemented properly or not.
But it's likely to affect in Wayanad also.
Everywhere. India, everywhere. So that is like actually what is happening in Kerala is that like they intentionally make the forest fire, and what is happening, they complain the tribal communities. They are complaining that it is because of the tribal communities that is the forest fire is happening, but the actual fact is something else.
So,
I had one slide of some ritual. Actually, that is part of Tulapadu. I am going to study one of these things, like the belief and customs. Now, part of now, how they are like as a part of the forest also like is part of the sacred groves, they protect it, part of the beliefs, and they are also performers, like they performers are also there, and there are a lot of all the tribal communities for the ceremonies like birth, death and other marriage ceremonies, they are had a lot of ritual practices. So I am going to study about that.
Ritual practices are indirectly helpful in.
Sorry?
Are these ritual practices indirectly helpful in conserving the forest and protecting the earth?
Yeah. Actually, that is also the kind of belief that, you know, that kind of they use a lot of medicines also, like this kind of ritual practices. So, that is also what we have. Actually, the problem with the even the because of this forest policy, there are other problems also, like how this this is the intellectual property, right? That the medicinal practices and medicinal knowledge. So like, there are so many issues going on that like. How it is getting protected, and there is intellectual property right policy is introduced for protection of the traditional medicine knowledge, but actually that is not applicable for the traditional medicine because that is for the industrial purpose, and that is introduced by developing countries, and developing countries are still fighting for the protection of the traditional medicine. So like there are some kind of documents documentation process is going on. That is part of by government and non-governmental agencies. But again, the problem is that the participation of the tribal communities in that process. So somebody else documented and they don't have any role. And also that like these all the tribal communities have their own language. So they must have, these people must have documented in the English, okay? So like they don't even know the Malayalam. And so like if they are thinking that okay, so we can use it in future, that is also not possible. It's their language, knowledge. So that is one thing.
And from like tribal healers who treat patients on their own regard, like aren't there also tribal people who are associated with collective medicines and then doing it to like Ayurvedic foundations? Like for instance, I guess Cortical Ayurvedic Sharma and all, which is the tribal people who collect medicine from different regions and then they should be. So how are these people like your like are the afterwards enough?
Yeah, that is, I actually discuss about, I've collected 10 that ST, like, distributed corporation cut data. Actually, if I not, that is started by the very backward tribal community called Kakamaika. When the developed tribal communities, they manipulated that and they are in a kind of very well positioned, that is like manage all of these things. The backward tribal community, they go to the forest and the current medicine, but still that is really risky because of the forest policy, they don't have the right to go to the forest. So like most of the time they are getting attacked by the forest guards. So and also, they collect, sometimes they collect the medicine, but they are not getting any kind of remuneration for that. They just get some amount of whatever. They are even for the medicine practice. So, what is happening when people come and they don't pay, like, they don't ask for the money, but when they have to continue it as a kind of living kind of mechanism, it is also not possible. That is why these days, the younger generation, they are hesitating to follow these practices.
Why don't they collect money for the medicine they offer?
Because they have the belief that it was sacred knowledge and sacred and secret. So they believe that in the modern days, they don't actually pay like charge anything. So these days also some people follow that, but some people, they collect the fee also like very, they use different kind of oils, they charge for most of the time for that. And the one of the institute called Hittas, they started a certification course because they had the charges for the Ayurveda medicine practitioners. That they do not have any kind of certificate at all. So they started a certificate course and they started practicing. So like in that course, actually they train the students that how to collect the medicines and what is the seeds and where to collect the medicine. A lot of the things are there. So like after that, some tribal communities, that is also the forward tribal communities, they are generally charging some amount of the money.
Is there a policy like excluding education for these tribal people, like, is there anything like that? Or if there is something like that, is it working properly or is there anything like failure in the system?
One of the reasons that, as I mentioned, I think in the qualification process, some of the developed, they are more or less participating in the qualification process because they know that they are developed and they are the government services and they know Malayalam and all. But the backward tribal communities, they still, the children are dropping out after 4th or 5th standard. So they can't follow the language. So nobody is taking initiative to teach them. So then they like go for that what the parents are doing. So like still, if even if they have reservation, what is happening? The developed tribal communities, they are getting it. They are getting that. So like nobody raised the words for the backward tribal communities. So their condition is still the same. So it is very difficult that to like educate. One of the main it should be that to educate them is a main kind of task that in front of the government and make, I don't know that.
But no initiative has been done for the backward community.
There should be, but
as of now there is nothing.
Yeah, actually I talk about the certificate course. One of the Pandya Tarun community, the Pandya boy, and see, these backward tribal communities, they have very strict kind of protection. They consider it's a very secret. So, they don't even share the knowledge with other family members, or anybody. But the developed tribal communities, there are some people, family wise it is transferring, otherwise, the community wise it is getting transferred. But this this whole thought that like his grandma's practicing, but she doesn't share it with anybody. So he approached a future tribal leader that to learn the traditional practicing knowledge, and at that is learning. So maybe the thing is that they don't when I went for feedback, they don't even they don't even say that they know the medicine practices, because they think that people approaching them for the education. They know that something is happening, but they don't know that what is happening. So they just know that we should not share it.
There is this tribal culture idea, whether we should assimilate them, whether there should be an integration of tribals to the mainstream society and all that. So, as somebody who has spoken with tribals closely, how do you look? Where do we draw the line between conserving them as who they are and bringing them into the mainstream? Is that a decision that, say, governments or sort of bureaucrats should take, or is that decision to be left to the tribal people? And if the decision is to be left to the tribal people, then is it up to them to decide? Well, see, we consider them as illiterate. So, is it to be left to the illiterate people to decide whether they should actually learn or not? Or is it more like a civilizing mission that we take by drawing them out and, putting them through the education system that we have provided? So, where do you think we draw them from?
I talked about the development of this. I think there are international organizations to look for the production of the tribal medicine knowledge. That is called the Center for Biodiversity and the World Inclusive Poverty Organization. The Center for Biodiversity, which is National Biodiversity and State Biodiversity, and also people biodiversity registered in the village level, that they can actually register. But the complications are still some of the tribal communities, they don't want to register because again they don't have the trust. So the thing is that I told you that developing countries are trying to develop their own protective mechanism. Actually, I was part of the this policy making with the IG ministry for government of India. So this IGC conference. Held the second IGC conference held in Geneva under the WIPO, World Intellectual Property Organization. But all the different states, countries have different interests. So the developed countries, they are saying that it should be in public. So there are so many traditional knowledge are already in public. But so many traditional knowledge are unqualified and also secret. And so the thing is that we propose policy is that there should be bottom approach. So, because the community can decide what they want, but there are narrowly diffused knowledge also there, that is secret knowledge, and widely diffused knowledge also there. So, if you are aware of the term, the turmeric and neem case is already exploited and it challenged by the court, and Like that is why there is a tradition called digital library. They started that, but again there is a problem with this because they are not protecting so many other knowledge apart from they are actually only covering that codified knowledge, not the uncodified knowledge. That is one thing. So this system is also classified under international patent classification system. So like it is easy that the developed countries can use it, but we don't know that. So that is also not the success. So like India actually want to ensure that all the people biodiversity register, they are doing well, and also we have to go and convince them that what is the need to document the knowledge. Also the participation should be there from the tribal communities. That is the big challenges that as I told that because of the language problem, that how it will happen, that is also one thing. But otherwise we promote the policies that part of the tribal community they want to know. Otherwise there is some kind of access and picture sharing mechanism that is also can decide by the community. Whoever can use it, they can decide that how they are actually going for the access and picture sharing mechanism. Whoever using the medicinal knowledge can share the benefit, but they can decide. And but that is in India, the main drawback is that is not also happening properly. Even that is also should happen under CBD National Biodiversity Act and all that should happen properly. So that all the narrow knowledge they can do that, but all the widely diffused knowledge the state actually can decide that, because it is not belong to any particular community. So state can actually decide that what they can go for. They can actually get the access and benefit and share among the community that can.
Sometimes available modern allopathic treatment also, or ayurvedic treatment also, they go to ayurvedic doctors and allopathic doctors for their own patients.
Some kind of medicine they go in, but the thing is that I've seen for the some of the medicinal leaders, they have 200-300 people are there as patients in one day, and that is mostly the people from the non-tribal communities. So maybe these tribal communities are most of the people know the paper, they use their own medicine practices, they must be using that. But some of the for the diseases they must be going for the medicine model.
Thank you.